My name is Takia Battle, and I'm from Warren County High School, and we're reading Alice Walker, The Color Purple, and I'll be starting on page 163. Dear Celie, at first there was the faintest sound of a movement in the forest, a kind of low humming. There was a chopping and sound of dragging. Right now, at this moment, I'm thinking about whoever is riding Celie, what are they doing in the forest, and where are they? There was a scent. Then a scent, some days of smoke. But now, after 2 months during which I or the children or Corinne has been sick, all we hear are choking, scrapping, and dragging. But every day we smell smoke. Right now I'm thinking either someone is smoking or a house or anything else are on fire. Today, one of the boys in my afternoon class burst out as he entered, "The road approaches, the road approaches." He had been hunting in the forest with his father and seeing it. What does he mean by "the road is approaching"? Every day from the village, every day now the villagers gather at the edge of the village near the cassava fields and watch the building at the road. And watching them, some of their stools and some squatted down on their hunches, all chewing cola nuts and making patterns in the dirt. I feel a great surge of love for them. Nettie probably feels a great surge of love for them because before she moved to wherever she was, she can relate by the stuff that she used to do, like playing in the dirt and making different patterns. Each day since the road approaches, they have been stuffing the road builders with goat meat, skillet mush, baked yams, and cassava, cola nuts, and wine balm. Well, it's nice for them to actually supply the workers with food, so they won't be outside hot and nothing to eat and nothing to drink. Each day is like a picnic, and I believe many countries have been running, although the road builders are from a different tribe, some distant to the north and nearer the coast, and their language is somewhat different. Nettie probably doesn't understand their language because she's probably used to hearing one language, and that's the language that Celie speaks, which is slang. I don't understand it. Anyway, though, the people of Olinka seem to. When we were in England, we met missionaries who sent the children back home when it was no longer possible to teach them in the bush. Right now, I'm thinking like the bush is either like a different kind of school that they call it, or something they just call homeschooling. But it's hard to imagine life here without the children. They love the open feeling of the village and love living in huts. They are excited by hunting and expertise of the men and the self-sufficiency of women in raising their crops. Right now, I'm thinking that basically it's like the old time movies where the lady works in the kitchen and the men goes to work and then come back and supposed to have a home-cooked meal waiting. No matter how down I may be, and sometimes I get very down indeed, a hug from Olivia or Adam completely restores me to the level of functioning, if nothing else. Their mother and I are not as close as we once were, but I feel more like their aunt than ever. And the three of us look more and more alike every day. About a month ago, Corinne asked me not to invite Samuel to my hut unless she was present. Why does Corinne not want Samuel with Nettie while she's not there? She said he gave the villagers the wrong idea. This was a real blow to me because I treasure his company. Do you think that Corinne doesn't want Samuel with Nettie because she's like Samuel? Since Corinne almost never visits me herself, I will have hardly anybody to talk to, just in friendship. But the children still come and sometimes spend the night when their parents want to be alone. Do you think Nettie enjoys the company from the children most of all, or Corinne, when she gets it? I love those times we roast ground nuts on the stove, sit on the floor, and study maps of all the countries in the world. No one else in the village wants to hear about slavery, however. They acknowledge their responsibility whatsoever. This is one thing about them that I definitely do not like. Maybe they don't want to hear about it because they have no interest in it. This friendship among women is something Samuel often talks about, because the women share a husband, but the husband does not share their friendship. It makes Samuel uneasy. It is confusing, I suppose. Right now I'm thinking, why does the women feel that they have to share their husband instead of all having one different husband? And it is Samuel's duty as a Christian minister to preach the Bible's directive of one husband and one wife. Samuel is confused because, to him, since the women are friends and would do anything for one another, not always, but more often than anyone from America would expect. And since they giggle and gossip and nurse each other's children, they must be happy with things they are. But many of the women rarely spend time with their husbands. Some of them were promised to old or middle-aged men at birth. What do you think the women actually liked being pushed off to a husband instead of being able to pick their own husband? Their lives always center around work and the children and other women. Since a woman cannot really have a man or a friend without the worst kind of and gossip, they indulge their husbands, if anything. You should just see how they make admiration over them, praise their smartest accomplishment, stuff them with palm wine and sweets. Right now, it seems like the women are doing everything that's to support the husbands, but the husbands aren't doing anything to support the women. You should just see how they make. No wonder the men are often childish, and a grown child is a dangerous thing, especially since among the Olenka, the husband has life and death power over the wife. If he accuses one of his wives of witchcraft or infidelity, she can be killed. So what would happen to the husband if the wife accused him of infidelity? Thank God, and sometimes Samuel's intervention, this has not happened since we've been here. But the story Tasha tells me often about such gruesome events that happened in the recent past, and God forbid that the children of a favorite wife shall fall ill. This is the point at which even the women's friendship breaks down, as each woman fears the accusation of sorcery from the other and from the husband. I feel like that if the women should get accused, and if they feel like she's doing it, she should be killed. Then if the husband get accused and he's doing it, he should be killed too. Merry Christmas to you and yours, dear Celia. We celebrate it here on the Dark Continent with prayer and song, a large picnic complete with watermelon, fish, fresh fruit, and barbecue. God bless you, Nettie.